fitting in. Depending on how old you are, those two words will mean very different things. To a preteen and teenager, fitting in and being accepted is crucial. No one wants to be different or stand out, because that leads to teasing, ridicule, and rejection. Even in adulthood, we want those around us to like and accept us, even if it's no longer as essential. Understandably, this tale about acceptance and conformity centers around a young lady on the edge of adulthood, about to be forced into a terrible scenario, so she can fit in.
Oh dear. That is you, isn't it?
Yes, that's me, before my transformation. I was a sight, wasn't I?
Mother, I think you were beautiful.
Well, I certainly don't.
Am I very homely now?
No, darling. Not to me. But afterwards, you'll be beautiful.
Mother, if I didn't want the transformation, I wouldn't have to have it, would I?
Darling, what are you talking about? The transformation is the most marvelous thing that could happen to a person.
Well, I could wait a little while, couldn't I?
Don't worry, darling. You're just nervous.
What you need is a glass of instant smile.
Just think, very soon now, you can look like that. Won't that be wonderful?
Number 12 Looks Just Like You was directed by Abner Biberman and written by John Tomerlin, based on a short story by Charles Beaumont. We're Becoming Beautiful along with Marilyn Kuberlay, played by Colin Wilcox. We're in a distant and alternate future where, upon hitting the age of 18, all men and women are given the choice to undergo an extensive physical surgery to appear as basically a supermodel in terms of looks. The operation also prolongs life and removes the genetic disposition towards various diseases. And I will say that whatever critique I might have for this tale, the world building isn't one of them. This is actually one of the strongest episodes in terms of quickly and firmly establishing the world in a believable and understandable way. Marilyn is causing trouble for herself and those around her because, to her mother's great shock, she adamantly refuses to get this operation. Following Mr. Serling's intro, we have a scene between her and her uncle where she makes her feelings clear. She doesn't want to exchange her uniqueness for a body out of a catalogue. She reiterates this feeling to her best friend, Val.
She told you, didn't she?
Yes, she did. Don't you think you're being awfully silly?
No. There's no law, is there?
But it isn't as if it hurts or anything. When they did mine, I didn't feel a thing.
I know that.
Well, you like the way I look, don't you?
I like you, Val. We're friends. I liked you before the transformation.
But you're missing the point. It's like getting a new hairstyle or new clothes or something. You just look better.
I'll look like one of those drawings that the bureau sends over.
But they're all beautiful. What's wrong with that?
It is wrong, Valerie. How will you know me? I mean, how will anyone know me? I don't want to look like everyone else. I want to look like me. And I'm not going to let them change me. I won't let them change me. Valerie, please help me.
And just as I praised the world-building, I must critique the dialogue. Oh, it's good, solid and well-written, but it's repetitive. The episode really only had one thing to say, and the topic is a big one, with a lot of facets to it. But once I heard Marilyn deliver rhetoric on it once, that was all I really needed. There are some other messages here, but they play second fiddle to the concept of rejecting conformity. Anyways, her mother, Lana, is so distressed at Marilyn's sudden and sturdy refusal to undergo the procedure that she takes her to a doctor. And we quickly unveil more of this world in slow and subtle ways. This doctor resides in what I can only describe as an evil lair. Nestled in a huge bunker somewhere, Marilyn and Lana proceed through sliding doors until reaching his office. The doctor, Rex, assumes Marilyn is anxious and eager to get the procedure, and assures her that she'll only have to be ugly for a few more days. The doctor is flabbergasted when it's revealed that she doesn't want it. But he reassures her. Well, sort of.
Your social adaptability is good. Your powers of reasoning quite normal.
Then why can't I make up my own mind? Marilyn, please. Why can't I? Why are you going to force me to do something that I don't want to do? You can't make me do it, can you? Nobody can make me do it.
Now, my dear child. No one has ever been forced to take transformation if he didn't want it. You see, the problem is simply to discover why you don't want it. And then to make the necessary correction.
In the next scene, the happy, slappy nature of the world as it has been shown to us begins to bring its menacing and ominous undertones to the forefront. Marilyn is led away to another part of the facility and meets a new doctor named Sig, who looks exactly like Rex. Obviously, this model is very popular. Sig starts by going through all the benefits of undergoing the transformation, like the increased lifespan and so forth that I mentioned earlier. In response, Marilyn talks about her father. Now, we've learned bits and pieces about her dad throughout the tale. We know that he died 5 years ago, and that Marilyn loved him very much. He apparently died in something called the Ganymede incident. We also know that, according to her, they talked about things of actual importance, like love and acceptance, and not just small talk, which seems to be the norm amongst others. As she goes on about her not being ugly but unique, and quoting books she's read, Sig becomes more and more agitated, and it becomes clear, both to Marilyn and the audience, that this transformation is more than just a physical surgery. Something is done to impress undesirable thoughts as well. This is how the state controls people. It becomes obvious that the transformation isn't actually optional, and Marilyn is effectively imprisoned until she selects a new body. She discusses her father again with Val, who comes to comfort her. And yeah, it's basically a reiteration of the same theme we've heard half a dozen times at this point in the narrative, but it is delivered with emotional power and sincerity.
I just don't see how anybody can stay married to the same husband for 100 years. And besides, I've heard that your father was pretty dull.
Valerie, stop it! Stop talking about my father! Can't any of you understand? I loved him! I cared about him. He was good and he was kind and he cared about me. Not what I wore, not the way I looked, but what I thought, what I felt. And what's more important, he cared about himself and his dignity as a human being. Valerie, he didn't die in the Ganymede incident. My father killed himself because when they took away his identity, he had no reason to go on living.
I just don't understand you, Marilyn.
Valerie, can't you feel anything?
Of course, silly. I feel good. I always feel good. Life is pretty, life is fun. I am all and all is one.
Marilyn is left sobbing as she finally understands that the transformation leaves everyone a mindless sack of smiles and prettiness, unable to hope or dream or really feel as a human is meant to. She decides to attempt an escape from the facility, which has only very passively detained her. She sneaks out into the corridor and begins passing identical hallway after identical hallway, unclear where to go. She even passes a nurse wheeling a newly transformed young woman down the hallway on a gurney. She rolls a dice and tries one of the doors, hoping for an escape route. But her dice come up snake eyes. She wanders right into the surgery room. The doctor is waiting for her and drags her to the table. Any hope of a happy outcome for Marilyn is shattered as the episode shifts to this downer ending.
Occasionally a young person has difficulty adjusting to the idea, but we've improved methods since the old days, and now it always turns out well in the end. Never fails. It's complete.
Mother!
Mother! Val! Look at me! What do you think?
You're beautiful, Marilyn. Just beautiful. And the nicest part of all, Val, I look just like you.
Portrait of a young lady in love. With herself. Improbable? Perhaps. But in an age of plastic surgery, bodybuilding, and an infinity of cosmetics, let us hesitate to say impossible. These and other strange blessings may be waiting in the future, which, after all, is the Twilight Zone.
A depressing end for our heroine, as she is whitewashed into a Barbie doll of a person. But if you can stomach the dark tone, then this is a solid episode that deserves a watch. It's not quite as perfect as the characters it portrays, though. As I've mentioned throughout this review, the moral is a strong one, but gets repeated ad nauseam. Like I said earlier, it had one thing to say, and it said it many times with slight variations. This is another clear example to me of a 10-minute story stretched to 25. As a result, pacing also suffers, with some scenes perfectly paced and cruising along, and others dragged out and circling the drain. On the other hand, the acting is fantastic, and the world-building is sublime. You take the good with the bad sometimes. I give this tale 2 out of 3 fedoras.